Welcome to a discussion of the card game Dungeon Crawler. You're looking at the outside of the main box here, which oddly does not say the name of the game on it. This is called Dungeon Crawler, and I guess this is meant to be the unbound set or group of cards, but it is basically the main game box. It plays according to the designer, solitaire, or multiplayer. You decide. The context of my review will be strictly about solitaire play, which is all I have done. It's marked as 15 minutes to 2 hours. I would say the 15 minutes part is not really very accurate when you count everything you need to do for the game, but it could play probably in 30 to 45 minutes at a minimum. And in addition to discussing the contents of this box, I will be referring to cards that come from actually a variety of the additional Delve sets that are offered. There are 5 offered now. They're each a 52-card set, and there's currently 1 expansion available, which is 80 or 82 cards. And right now, Kickstarter has finished up a second expansion that will be available perhaps later in 2016. So this video is going to be initially a discussion of the game. I will give some examples of gameplay, but it will not be a playthrough. And then I will have a review and analysis of the game in terms of its strengths and weaknesses, and offer some verdict or discussion on what sort of player might most benefit from this game. This is not a playthrough video, but in order to understand the discussion and analysis, it's important first to be situated as to the basics of how the game plays. There are 2 decks of cards here, your dungeon deck and your crawler deck. The dungeon deck is in effect your foes, and the crawler deck is the resources and skills and tactics and equipment that you have to battle your way through the various dungeons that you will encounter. The top row here depicts the 4 adventurers that will be accompanying you on your journey, and they each offer various resources that you can use to help yourself, and we will get into the details on these a little bit as we move through some gameplay examples. This number down here represents their life total. Along the side of the board here are 3 quests laid out, depicted by the treasure chest icon. These describe different conditions to be met for victory in the game. And the game rules provide a variety of different victory conditions. You can choose for the hardest game to meet all 3 quests that you lay out, or you could choose to meet 2 of them. You can also accomplish, quote unquote, winning the game by making your way successfully through the entirety of the dungeon deck, as long as you still have life remaining in at least one of your adventurers. The cards that are your encounter cards for each turn of the game are pulled from this dungeon deck, and the cards that you use to, in a sense, fight the dungeon cards are pulled from the crawler deck. So, in effect, the basic gameplay involves taking cards from this crawler deck that are in your hand and using them to combat cards that you pull from this dungeon deck. So let's talk a little bit about what it means to be creating the game as you play, and to be playing a game that relies on pulling cards from decks that you construct. On the dungeon side of things, what this means is that you will need to basically seed a dungeon deck, seed a foe's deck of monsters and other effects that you're going to fight, and then also create the crawler deck that you're going to use to fight it. Along with this, you will need to make sure that whatever quest cards you're pulling are able to be satisfied by what you put in the dungeon deck. So if you're choosing a quest card that requires you to, for example, slay 3 dragons, you have to make sure that you put at least three dragons into your deck. Now, the designer of the game has provided on their website some downloadable pages that will provide you, if you wish, with a pre-prepared dungeon deck that you can go through your cards and pull all these cards and events and terrains and traps and stick them together in a dungeon deck with the quests that they suggest. The problem with this is that it requires you basically to purchase every single pack and expansion that they make in order to come up with these amount of cards, and that can get, frankly, quite expensive and might not be something that you want to do at the beginning of your experience with this game until you're sure it's going to be a good fit. They do say, of course, you can make substitutions and you don't have to. It says feel free to substitute cards when needed and enjoy. Of course, you can do that, but to some degree that defeats the purpose if you're interested in something that is pre-made for you, and so you don't have to do this. So this is something to know going in that you will need to do in terms of setting up your opposition deck, and then, of course, setting up the deck that you're going to be using to make your way through the encounters. There are four different types of dungeon cards in this game, and we're going to take a look at the four different cards. I think one of the strengths of this game is that it really makes use of a variety of card types in terms of the card effects. So the first card type are what they call characters, which are basically the monsters or creatures that you will encounter in the course of your travels through the dungeon. And this one here is a giant gray spider. And you'll see that the effect here, I'm not going to go through everything that's listed, but one of the effects which happens immediately is something called Snare, which means it will immediately take one of your cards. Now, this is very thematic because it's a spider, and of course spiders take things. So this is just one simple example of how the attributes of a card really do fit thematically with the type of, in this case, character that the card is. A second type of card that exists is also something you would expect, pretty typical for dungeon crawls, is a trap. This card here depicts a 20-foot pit trap, and as befitting a pretty nasty trap, it has a pretty nasty effect. In this case, it is going to, in essence, put one of your adventurers out of commission for that turn. The third type of card that is part of the dungeon are terrain cards. This particular terrain card is a graveyard, and again, befitting the theme of a graveyard, essentially what this card will do is offer any undead and spirits characters that you have or creatures that you have in play additional stamina or additional difficulty in defeating, because that's what a graveyard would do for those characters. So again, there's a variety of terrain cards, but this is just one example of how the effect of that card really matches what the actual card is. And the final type of card is an event card. This particular event card is called Rushed, and what it causes is the effect that you, the player, cannot use a certain portion of your crawler cards, which are anything that are depicted as a skill card. And we'll get into the different types of crawler cards in a moment. But again, you can see, if you think thematically, what does it mean to be rushed? Well, I'm rushed, so I can't do everything that I want to do. And that's what this card causes to happen when it comes into play as part of the dungeon. So when taken together, all the dungeon cards, the effect, the terrain, the characters, and the traps come up randomly in the course of your playthrough, and it is that environment or that scenario that you have to deal with your crawler cards. And we'll take a look at those crawler cards and the four types of crawler cards right now. Now we're going to take a closer look at the four different types of crawler cards that you have. These are the cards that you hold in your hand during the course of the game to help you make your way through the dungeon. The first type of card is something you would expect, which is equipment. And these cards offer you various forms of equipment. Here we have a magic longsword, and there is text on the card that will explain to you exactly what benefit that card offers to you. The second type of card are skill cards. And the skill cards, in this case, for example, Whirlwind Attack, do what you would expect, which is offer some boost or benefit or twist on an existing skill level that you may already have. So this one has an effect on combat that allows you to basically deal extra damage. There are magic cards in this game. In this case, this is a form of a magic card that it's called Earthen Form, and this will offer you essentially additional strength and power for the course of the game turn in which it is in play. And the final type of crawler card are tactics cards. And these cards allow you in some way to change the rules, perhaps a little bit, of the combat or the gameplay to your benefit. So in this case of search object, you are allowed to go back into your deck and get some additional equipment cards. So that is a tactic that you can use as you play this card. So those are the four types of crawler cards that will help you as you make your way through the game. Let's take a closer look at the adventure card here. I mentioned earlier that chiefly what the adventurers do is offer you some resources to use as you make your way through the deck. There are four types of resources in the game, and they are corresponding to the resources you have for your crawler cards, and these are represented by equipment, which here is this sort of bag here, and magic, which is represented here by the stars here. So she's offering you four magic. There are skills, a skill level, which is represented by the hands, and then tactics, which are represented by the flag. So your wolf elf scout here is offering you four tactics. The way the game works is your band of adventurers, the four groups of people that you have, are only offering you the highest level of resource. So you would be pulling your resource level of magic, for example, from your gypsy stormcatcher here, as opposed to somebody else in your party who may have fewer of those resources. And how are these resources impacting you? Well, when you play cards from your hand, so this is that search object card we looked at earlier, you will notice here in the upper left corner this corresponding flag. This is a tactic card, and you need to have one tactic resource in order to play it. So chiefly, the purpose of these adventurers is to provide you with the resources which become replenished every turn, as long as that adventurer is in play, and the adventurer remains in play as long as they have any life left. A lot has been written about the issues in this game in terms of components and rules in particular. I'm not going to spend too much time on that, but for those of you who are watching a video about this game or learning about this game for the first time, it does bear mentioning a couple of things. This is the rule booklet that comes with the game, which is widely understood to be relatively useless from the almost indecipherable layout of some of the pages to actual inaccuracies in some of the rules and, frankly, some omissions of some pretty key rules parts, which are just mind-boggling given what playtesting one hopes occurred. It's imperative to go to the website and download basically a number of documents. You've got this starter's guide document, which contains basically a walkthrough of the game. It has you set up the various decks in a certain order. This takes a bit of time, but it does familiarize you with some of the cards, and it has a clear, very clear reference to what is on the cards, clarity which is absolutely missing from the official rulebook or player's guide. You also need to download the basic introduction and core rules, because this has the correct information, it has the legible information, and it has the complete information. And finally, you would be also downloading the specifically solitaire rules if you wanted to play it solitaire. So at a minimum, those are three documents you're going to need to download. Additionally, there are provided a one-page sort of setup sheet of rules that can come in handy, and as well a double-sided or two pages of summary of the key terms that are on each card that can also be quite useful. In terms of the other issues of components with the game, it does come with some very badly made tokens which have a lot of variability in color, as you can see here looking at these two, for example. And these may have come with different expansions, I'm not really sure, because they all got mixed together, but nevertheless, some are just illegible in terms of what that actually says on it, and all of them are really just poor quality. And again, one wonders about the decision to include such cheaply made tokens rather than just having the gamer provide their own. And finally, the card backs of the cards that come in different sets vary quite a bit. Now, does this matter for gameplay? Honestly, not really, because when you're setting up your crawler decks, you are looking at the face of the card, not the back, and once it's into a deck, it really doesn't matter what you pull from, but it is an unfortunate, pretty significant variance in color there. And lastly, a design choice that is a little confusing to me, which is up here, the icon for the particular card set, which can come into play if you're trying to set up a particular deck. These are two different card sets, and again, one just wonders at the decision to make these icons so similar, because you can be sorting through hundreds of cards if you have them all that you are choosing from, and it's just a little bit annoying to have something that is so similar when you want it to be differentiated. Question the design choice there. Lastly, there was in the original game no way of tracking any of the resource points. Ricky Royal provided on BGG a little sheet that allowed you to track the very important resource allocation that you have, and my understanding from the Thorn expansion Kickstarter is that this card will be reproduced in the next expansion, but again, just really boggles the mind as to why the original game, which counted resources among its key elements in terms of game design, had absolutely no way of tracking them, and honestly, actually not really much mention of it with any degree of clarity in the rules. So that is a little bit of the work you'll need to do to get the game up and running in terms of basic components. It will be an obstacle to some. I think once you take care of this, basic printing out, you are ready to roll with a pretty comprehensive and understandable rule set once you put in a little time to read it. Let's talk a little bit about this game as an adventure game. The name Dungeon Crawler to me implies that there is some adventure aspect, particularly with the notion that you are playing this game with a set of adventurers, of which these cards are some of them, and that some of the victory conditions are involving quests, of which this and the other cards are some possible quests. So when you describe the game that way, it implies to me a bit more of an adventuring story than is present here, and certainly a bit more of adventure or dungeon development than is present here. And in fact, in this game, there's no dungeon development at all. The reason for this is that the way each encounter is set up has to do with pulling cards that have a value in this corner that adds up to the number 5. So once you have hit the number 5 in value, you have stopped pulling your cards, and that set equals the dungeon for that encounter. You could, as a result, depending on how your cards are shuffled, pull, for example, these two cards out initially, and this could be your very first encounter. This could be a particularly difficult encounter. Likewise, at the very end of the game, you could pull a series of cards with much lower values and cards that are therefore much easier to deal with. So there really is no linear development at all, and there is no sense of going deeper into a level of a dungeon or the game is getting any more difficult, etc. Likewise, with your adventurers here, you are really using them, as I mentioned before, simply for the provision of certain resources that you can draw upon to use your skills. And they do have this class icon here. And the class icon is used to boost up cards in your crawler deck to give you the better advantage of that card if you can match the class icon with the card. So this person, for example, is meant to be a thief, and the cards that they boost presumably have to do with thieving activities. This is a wizard here, and this is a warrior. And so you're using your adventurers to provide these resources, but beyond that, they don't really advance at all. In fact, all they do really is diminish over the course of the game as they take on wounds and their life total goes down and down, and then eventually they are eliminated. And then when they are eliminated, so with them goes their contribution to the resource pool, and you can lose your advantage there of, say, for example, 3 magic if you're down to adventurers that have no magic to offer. But there really is very little beyond that that they are offering. They're fairly generic, and again, they are contributing resource pools, but when you're playing, at least when I'm playing, it's almost an afterthought as to the actual sort of character, you know, that this person is a dwarf or that this person is a high elf. That aspect of the game feels very pasted on and ultimately irrelevant. What you're just dealing with is the amount of resources that they offer. And similarly, with the quests, it feels like a real missed opportunity on these quests to have something that resembles even a basic story. This is the only quest, Rescuing the Damsel, which requires you to complete a win condition. There's a trap in the dungeon deck that you would be using with this quest, and you need to successfully complete that win condition on that card, and therefore you quote-unquote rescued the damsel and fulfilled this quest. You know, even that's a pretty light story, but at least there's somewhat of a story in our narrative there, and I don't think it's an accident that this particular quest is the one that the game designer chooses to highlight on their website, because it's the one that kind of seems the most like a dungeon crawl would have. The other quests, though, they have very nice names, like here the stars align and there's nice art here, and it tells you that you have to sort of get certain costed dungeon cards in play. Really, all the other quests are just about various types of card management. There isn't much of a story involved. I mean, you can try to make one up, I suppose. Like here, the Journey's End really is solved if you just get through 15 terrain cards into your grave or your discard pile. So, you know, sure, you can make up some story in your mind about traveling through various terrains and successfully navigating them until you have dismissed or put into the discard or grave pile 15 of them, but really all the quests are is about card management, and I think that was a missed opportunity here on the part of the designers to try in some way to have even just a little bit more of a light story aspect, given that this is meant to be a dungeon crawling type of game. So on that point, I think there's a little bit of a weakness here, and the flip side of it is it just signifies a little more that this is ultimately a game about card management and card puzzles with a dungeon theme and dungeon attributes and dungeon type drawings and fantasy type drawings put onto it. At the heart of this game are the encounters between your crawler cards and the dungeons that you create. And one of the great benefits to this game is how easy it is to set this up once you have created the decks from which you'll be playing. So to create the dungeon, you simply pull cards in the amount totaling 5. And once you hit 5, you stop and you've created the extent of your dungeon and encounter for that turn. There are some rules as to what to do if you go over the 5 limit, but we're not going to get into that now. There are some great playthrough videos already existing, and I'm not even going to attempt to do that. I just want to give you a basic sense of some of the things that make this game quite interesting. So here we pulled our encounter, and we came up with a minor abomination who's lurking about a labyrinth with a gargoyle there as well. And we can look and see the various effects that these cards have. And again, not going through all of this, that is for other people to do, but just want to give you a bit of the flavor of the game. What you would then do is look at your own hand and see what you had in your hand to deal with the dungeon that you're currently facing. And in this case, you've got some magic ability. This will allow you to look and see what's coming next, basically, if you decide to play this card. You've got some good old shield, a basic equipment card that is going to offer you some protection from the attacks you may face from this dungeon. You've got a sword, and this is going to be an offensive card for you to give you some power to inflict some wounds. And you've even got a nice little tactic here in the form of this Fey ally who would let you simply remove a terrain card from play if you chose to do that. And in this case, this could be this kind of nasty labyrinth that will stick around for a few turns, actually 3 turns with a time limit of 2. This is going to stick around and give you some potential trouble. So you could possibly deal with that by using one of your tactics cards. And here we have another tactics card too. And this one would let us search our own deck and get some more equipment into our hand. So we would have some decisions to make about how to approach this particular dungeon, whether we went straight at it with the equipment that we had, or we tried to use some tactics to, in effect, go around it and save these equipment cards for later on. And this is a pretty typical decision-making process that is the meat and potatoes of this game. And ultimately, if you like this type of decision-making, if you like being able to face down some monsters or funny little abominations, as it were. This guy's almost kind of cute in a weird way. With skills, with equipment, with tactics that involve something more than simply bashing it over the head, then you will enjoy this game. This is a puzzle card game with a dungeon theme. Once you get through the rules and once you get through setting up your decks, it plays very easily, and I think that is a strong suit of the game. It is billed as both solitaire and multiplayer, and I think competitive as well. To me, it's really a solitaire game. It plays seamlessly as such, and it offers a very fun and relatively light and sometimes challenging puzzly dungeon experience. If you are looking for a deep adventure with a rich story and danger and quests and characters you can become attached to, this is not the game for you. If you're looking for a game with a fantasy theme that offers some card-based puzzles to deal with and satisfying choices and some tough decisions to make throughout the game, you will probably like this game. It plays wonderfully as a solitaire experience and really does seem to have been made as a solitaire game, despite being billed as being able to be played in many different fashions. To me, it really has the feel of something that was designed primarily for solitaire play. It is very satisfying in that regard. If you are willing to put in a little time to download the proper rule set, to read up on the rules, and to watch a couple of videos that do more of playthrough than I have done here, I think you will potentially get a lot out of this game. It is fun, it is light, it is something that you can set up and play and go away from and come back to. You know, one of the downsides of the game, not having real story development and each turn somewhat seeming like the prior turn in terms of what's going on, is a benefit to people who don't have necessarily even 45 minutes in a row to sit down and just play a game. You can come back to this game at the end of one turn and basically just pick it right back up and continue along without really losing very much. So it's a mixed bag. I think the designer, unfortunately, has made a road more difficult for himself by some of these basic issues of the rules and the components, but he has done a lot to try to support the game since its original publication, and I know with the coming Kickstarter expansion of Thorn, there may be more interest in the game, and hopefully this video has provided somewhat of a context for what the game can be. I would rate it highly for somebody who's interested in fantasy, in the dungeon crawl experience, and who likes a puzzle type of card play game. I give it a smiley face for that, and hope that this video provided you some context for thinking about whether or not it's the game for you.